made of a long chain of nucleotides. There's, in essence, four different nucleotides. Three nucleotides in a row code for one amino acid, then long chains of amino acids bunch and fold to form proteins. Proteins basically do or control all the things in the cell, from being enzymes, to constructing cell membranes, to all the other stuff. The DNA sequence can change by bits moving around, mistakes in the way it's copied, environmental damage and whatnot. That leads to different amino acids being coded for and different proteins being made. And DNA is shuffled around and mixed and matched from things like sexual reproduction. These are some of the ways our blueprints can change. This is sort of how things evolve. To better understand why things evolve, let's first look at why things don't evolve. If something dies before it reproduces, then it's not evolving. If that DNA doesn't get copied into a new organism. When we're looking at evolution, we're basically looking at the changes in the blueprints along lines of reproduction. So if an organism leaves behind no offspring, those blueprints aren't evolving. Keep in mind, it's not the DNA itself changing. It's just the information, the order of the nucleotides that's being copied and changed. New DNA is assembled with each new cell, and the old DNA eventually falls apart. The thing that passes from one individual to the next is the information, the order of the nucleotides. Over time, the incidental and random changes in the sequence, and whatever works long enough to reproduce again, results in all the different genomes and organisms we see. Evolution doesn't aim for any organism or trait. All the organisms that we see today are just the ones that came from an unbroken line of organisms that reproduced before dying, with all those inherited changes in their blueprints. So no organism that is around today is any more or less evolved than any other that is around today. They've all reproduced down a line from the beginning of life to the present, and they're all equally successful. So to pass on blueprints, creatures need to get nutrients and grow, find a mate if you're sexual, and not die long enough to reproduce. Since it's your genes that influence these things, genes will have a better chance of being passed on if they code for traits that help survival and reproduction, like genes for beaks that can get at more food, genes for camouflage that make them hide from predators, or genes for something that makes sounds to attract mates. If a gene codes for a trait that doesn't help reproduction, then it'll have a decreased chance of being passed on. Like, let's say a bird just happened to have some genes that led to some cool horns. Maybe they look impressive, but the extra weight prevents it from flying, and all the energy it spent trying to make those horns could have gone to something more useful. So it can't get food as easily, and it dies a lot from getting eaten by bears and other ground predators, which decreases their chances of reproducing. If there were a number of these birds in a population for whatever reason, they wouldn't survive as long or reproduce as much as those without these genes. Over time, you'll stop seeing this particular gene for horns because those with it have an increased chance of dying before they reproduce. This is the basis for why things evolve. If a gene codes for something that helps survival or reproduction, then it'll reproduce more. It helps not to think about the individual as the thing that's being replicated, but the genes. It's counterintuitive to do because genes mostly don't reproduce on their own, mostly, and the reproduction requires the actions of that entire vessel. So genes mostly code for traits that help their vessel, but only insofar that it helps themselves reproduce. Remember, the vessel dies. The old DNA falls apart. It's the code that goes from one generation to the next. That's the thing that's being reproduced. The information stored as DNA is the thing that has to benefit from the protein. In terms of evolution, the individual doesn't matter that much. Let's look at an example. Let's presume there's some sort of set of genes that code for something that makes a parent care for its offspring, like genes for paternal love or something. These genes actually hurt the individual, the parent's chance of survival and future reproduction. They're spending time and energy caring for young when it could go off and just make more, and leave behind more copies. Since this gene hurts the individual, how can it survive and be passed on? Why doesn't this gene go away the same way genes for sick-ass horns on a bird would? Why doesn't every animal abandon its young the way a lot of fish do? It's because the offspring also has this child-caring gene. This gene leads to a trait that increases the reproduction of a copy of itself in the child. So even though this gene hurts the individual that it's in, and ultimately itself, it still increases the survival of future copies of that gene, which keeps it in circulation. If we're looking at it from the perspective of the gene, then everything outside the gene, even other genes of the same organism, is just the environment to it. Like those same genes for horns that didn't work with the genes of the bird, in a different environment with different genes, may be beneficial for reproduction. The gene can code for any protein. That's what genes do. That protein is that gene's effect on the world outside itself. It can do anything that a chain of amino acids can do. But if that protein does anything but support that gene's reproduction in some way, meaning it's not helping this happen, or it's not helping this happen in the child like we saw, then while that's all fine and good, there's not really a strong reason to see that gene after the individual. Each individual is a hodgepodge of a whole bunch of different genes coding for a whole bunch of different proteins. And with sexual reproduction, genes are shuffled around with each new individual. What this means is that over long periods of time, genes kind of sort of act on their own. Let's say there's one gene that codes for a trait that helps reproduction, and another gene that hurts reproduction. And let's say that this makes sense. Sure, the red gene will hurt the blue gene sometimes when they're together, but other instances, for example, in instances where they're not together, this individual will outcompete this one, meaning it'll make more or better children. Some of them will die, as happens. They'll get eaten or they'll fall into a snake pit. But since there's more of these guys and they're theoretically better at surviving, this blue gene will have a better chance of remaining than this red gene, even though they're together sometimes. What's being implicated by saying everything outside the gene is the environment to it is that the gene won't code for something that helps something else. Genes code to help the vessel they're in and have evolved to work well with the other genes in that organism, but only because it helps itself. If a gene helps something else at its own expense, then each generation this gene will have a decreased chance of being passed on. Anyways, to summarize, genes are shuffled around with each new organism, so when you want to look at what's being passed down and evolving, you gotta look at the individual genes. The more a gene helps reproduction, the more it reproduces, and the more you see it. The less a gene helps, the less you see it. Such that in the end, or I guess in the present, the genes that remain tend to be ones that code for traits that are relatively self-serving for reproduction. Evolutionary theory people often talk about things only in terms of reproduction, like camouflage is good because it helps reproduction. I think because reproduction is the more important thing, it's sort of a shorthand for saying camouflage helps survival so that the organism can go off and reproduce more. But can there be a creature that lives forever and maybe only reproduce more adaptive behaviors based on it all? Things without brains tend to have less involved behaviors, things along the lines of if notice certain chemical, then follow certain chemical. So instead of it being a matter of things that followed that chemical left behind more copies than things that did not follow that chemical, things with brains can learn in one lifetime which chemicals to eat and which to leave alone. Some behaviors are inherited before.